It's time for
Family Fun!
Something more than gold.
A certain man of greed lived in days of old. Though he was rich, he felt the need for something more than gold. Oh yes, my friends, there's something more than gold. Then know your sins are all forgiven. There's something more than gold. It happened on a certain day. This little man was told that Jesus soon would pass that way with something more than gold. Zacchaeus was not tall and weak. In order to be whole, climbed up in a sycamore tree for something more than gold. Oh yes, my friends, there's something more than gold. You know your sins are all forgiven. Something more than gold. Jesus stood beneath that tree, saw the little man. He said, I want to die with you. Zacchaeus was so glad. Oh yes, my friends, there's something more than gold. You know your sins are all forgiven. Something more than gold. He obeyed and soon found out half had not been told. Where love and joy and peace abound is better far than gold. So he obeyed and soon found out half had not been told. Where love and joy and peace abound is better far than gold. Oh yes, my friends, there's something more than gold. You know your sins are all forgiven. Something more than gold. Oh yes, my friends, there's something more than gold. You know your sins are all forgiven. Something more than gold.
Roll ye away the stone.
Do you remember the story in the Bible when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead? All the people around who were watching couldn't raise up Lazarus, but there was something they could do. Jesus said to them,
roll ye away the stone.
They had to do what they could, and then Jesus would do what they couldn't. And what did the people do? Did they argue with him and say,
what's the use of rolling away the stone? He's already been dead for 4 days.
It's impossible, so why should we even try moving that huge, heavy stone?
But no, the people believed that Jesus was going to do the miracle that they couldn't. And they went right to work and moved the stone. They showed their faith in Jesus by their obedience in doing what he asked. They said,
wow, he's going to raise the dead.
I believe it. Let's hurry up and get the stone out of the way.
Yes, let's make room for God to work. Let's go.
Lazarus! Come forth!
Then Jesus raised up Lazarus. You do what you can, and God will do what you can't. Praise the Lord. All the way through the Bible, God asked men to do something first, before God answered them. God told Moses to strike the rock, and then he'd bring forth water. Moses could have said,
"Well, Lord, I don't think there's any water in this rock. It seems like a crazy idea. Besides, I'd rather just see you do it."
But Moses didn't say that. He went ahead by faith, took a stick and hit the rock, expecting God to do the rest. And God did. Water poured forth, and all the people were able to drink as much as they needed. Praise God! The Lord doesn't usually do for us the things that we can do for ourselves. He wants us to work for it, and then He does what we can't do. Even if it's hard work sometimes, like those men rolling away the stone in Lazarus' grave. They probably had to huff, puff, and roll away that huge stone. But it was something they could do. It showed their faith that Jesus would do the rest. We do the possible. And He does the impossible. God wants to see you obey first. He helps you if you do your part and obey and help yourself as much as you can. Do what you know you can do, and then don't worry about the rest that you can't do. God will take care of that. Obedience comes before the blessing. Obedience comes before the reward. The minute you start obeying and working, God will do His part without fail. He will bless. So, roll ye away the stone. Praise the Lord.
Why good and evil?
Your Peter brought you something. A nice orange juice.
Oh, thank you so much.
Hey, how are you today, Peter?
Not really good. I don't understand why I don't feel better and have to stay in bed.
Okay, Peter. Don't be discouraged. I'm sure you're going to be better soon. You know, everyone is praying for you. You know what? It reminds me of a lesson by Grandpa called Why Good and Evil. You want me to explain to you?
Oh, yes, please.
Okay, Jesus, bless this time. Jesus, please. Well, Grandpa tells us that sometimes we need to have some bad in order to appreciate the good. You see, for example, when do you appreciate the light from us, Peter? When it's all bright and sunny?
Well, I don't know. Oops, the lights went out.
Oh, that's a good illustration. You see, now we can appreciate the light when the electricity is going to come back.
Oh, the lights are on again. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, yes. You see, Peter? In the same way, Peter, what makes us appreciate to be healthy?
When we are sick?
Yes, like the little girl. You see, she is sick just like you, Peter.
Oh, I understand. And she will really appreciate good health when she gets better again.
Yes, yes. Oh, it's a good time to be closer to Jesus and to listen to Him. Like Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. She couldn't appreciate fully the beautiful garden until they had to leave it after they had disobeyed.
Yes, they learned the difference. They could remember how nice the garden was.
Yes, you see, that's right. So, you see, if we have a little problem sometimes, or if things don't go the way we want, then we need to first learn.
Yes, like Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for good to them that love the Lord.
So, did we have fun together, Peter? We had a good time to learn about why good and why evil.
Oh, thank you, Uncle Jeff. I'm feeling better now, and I understand better why I'm sick. Can I have my juice now, please?
Yes, you may. Here, the juice. Okay, I love you, Peter. We had so much fun together. I love you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
All from one gospel track.
Look in dirt. Piece of paper with words on it. Must be message from God. Must go show Ota, my father. Oh, great chief, Ota, my father, I greet you.
Ah, my son, I'm very pleased to see you, looking so well this fine day. What do you have in your hand?
Oh, great chief, Ota, my father, I have found white man paper with words on it. I must find man to help me read it.
How you do this, my son?
I must make a long journey to village, to white man village, and there find a man to help me read.
Go then, my son. When you return, you shall be teacher to all men in village of whom you read from this paper.
Thank you, Ota, my father. I will go make preparations for my journey now.
Who's there?
Tubal, son of great chief Ota, from distant village of Zamarunda.
Come. Where did you say you're from?
I come from faraway village of Zamarunda.
I've heard of that distant village. It's past the great river, is it not?
Yes, very far away, village.
Over 250 miles away. You poor man, you must be tired. Please come and tell me why you've traveled so far. My house is not far. Please
Thank
come.
Thank you. You are a very kind woman. Are you missionary?
Yes, I am. Please come.
Oh, yes, thank you.
So you can teach it to the people in the village?
Learn to read.
Well, I will certainly teach you how to read.
Thank you.
Let's start now. Look. God.
God.
Is.
Is.
Love.
Love.
Very good.
Oh, I can read.
How to read this tract, Mrs. Amethyst, and for giving me God's love in my heart.
I will go and teach him to the many villages where I come from.
This is a special gift for you. It's a New Testament. You can learn more about Jesus.
Thank you. You are most kind.
Goodbye, Chico. I'll pray for you every day.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. So Tubal returned to his village and began boldly preaching to all the love of Jesus. Many people came to hear him, and in only 1 year, 1,500 people received Jesus, and all through one little gospel tract. So that should encourage us to keep on witnessing Jesus' love and passing out his word, because there's no telling just how far it can go. A little bit of love goes a long, long way.
I had a dream, and in the dream it was evening twilight, just before dark, a time of day that Maria and I love best when we take our long walks together. We were coming home along this country road, and as we walked along, I suddenly heard a voice calling me from above, saying,
"Pastor! Pastor!"
So I looked up to see who was calling me, and it appeared that we were at the foot of a rather high embankment. On the top of it stood a little cottage, and looking over the fence stood this very tall woman. She looked like she was about 10 feet tall. She motioned me to come up, saying,
"Come up, Pastor. I have something for you. I have some milk for you."
So I began to climb the embankment, which was quite steep and a little dangerous. At the top, there was a little balcony built out from her house, so that in order to get up onto her property, you had to go through this hole in the floor of this little balcony. There were a few things lying over the hole to cover it, so I had to move them out of the way with my hand. It was a little difficult, but as I crawled up halfway through the hole, she looked down at me with a smile and handed me this strange container of milk, shaped like a big, fat Aladdin's lamp. I looked into her eyes, and suddenly I knew that this extremely tall woman was an angel. So I took the milk, and in awe and wonder, I thanked her and slid back down to the road and Maria, who was standing there wondering what in the world was going on. I carried the milk almost as though I had something magic in my hand. I said to Maria, "This is just what we needed to go with our bread and cheese." So we walked on together to our room to enjoy our simple meal of bread and cheese and milk. The milk container was very white and very clean, and apparently this treasure that the Lord was giving me of his sincere milk of the word from the heavenlies was something that I had to keep very clean and pure and in a safe container and be able to carry with me to feed the hungry. It must be symbolic. The fact that it was the last hours of the day was symbolic of the hour in which God has given us this sincere milk of the word. In the last hours of this world, just before the darkness of the darkest night it has ever experienced in the coming tribulation. The milk was God's gift, but I had to make an effort to get it and receive it in a struggle to push the hindrances and obstacles of the devil aside and to climb halfway through the hole, halfway to heaven to get it. So that's what I did, and thank God I did, or you wouldn't have received the sincere milk of the word all these years. As I have gone time and again, halfway to heaven, to get it for you and bring it back from the heavenlies, to be your milkman of the word. May God help you to get halfway to heaven and receive his word yourselves. You don't have to always just receive it from me. You can get it directly from the Lord himself and grow to be a strong pastor, to feed his sheep with the sincere milk and even a strong need of the word in these last hours of the world's history when they will need it so much. May God bless and keep you drinking this word from heaven.
Hello, on, children. Come on in. Come on in. Fun by the stream. Do you know what the fruits of the Spirit are? The Apostle Paul told us about them in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. Do you want to quote it with me? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And the fruit that we're going to learn about today is peace. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peace is the opposite of confusion and chaos. Jesus can give our spirits a quiet peace and trust in Him. And the peace of God, which passeth understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Even if we don't understand everything that's happening in our lives, Jesus can keep our hearts and minds with His peace.
Let's memorize now.
There was once a war in a country called Vietnam. Some of the American soldiers were captured by the enemy and taken to a city called Hanoi, which was the capital of Vietnam. There were guards watching the plaza. After being in prison for a few weeks, the man asked one of the guards if he had a Bible. But the guard just shook his head and said, no. They were desperate to hear something that would uplift and encourage them. So, they decided to review all the verses they knew from the Bible and write them down. Each of the prisoners took a turn quoting the verses he knew. But they soon realized that they didn't know very many Bible verses at all. In fact, the only verses they knew were John 3:16, Psalm 23, the Lord's Prayer, the Ten Commandments, and a few other verses. They kept on trying to remember more verses, but they would just get confused and get the verses all mixed up together. They felt very bad that they didn't have more of God's Word stored in their hearts. The Bible tells us that the Word of God dwells in you richly. That means that we should have a lot of Word stored in our hearts. There may come a time when we can't read our Bibles or more letters, and all we'll have is the Word stored in our hearts. Always need the Word to make us strong. So let's all be faithful to memorize and review now while we can, so we'll be able to use the Word now and in the coming days ahead.
Talk time. Forgiveness.
Disobedient? What did he do?
He took a special picture of Satan to give to my mommy and colored it in himself. He did it on purpose.
Maybe he did it all wrong.
Oh, Auntie Ruth, he said that he did it, and I know he had loving beliefs. I told all the children how Satan got picture for my mommy.
Well, let's see. Jesus, please give us wisdom as we talk about this problem. Show us what to do and give us your answers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. He just needs to get corrected.
So you think he did it on purpose and he didn't apologize or anything?
Well, he apologized, but sorry doesn't fix it. I still can't use my picture anymore.
Okay. Well, I'll try to talk to him and find out what's happened. If he did it on purpose, that really wasn't loving.
I'm so upset with him.
Sammy, have you ever done anything that was wrong?
Did you do it on purpose?
Have you ever made mistakes or disobeyed sometimes?
Yes, maybe sometimes.
And did your Lord and your teachers forgive you then if you were sorry?
Yes.
It feels pretty nice to be forgiven, doesn't it?
Oh, yes, it sure does.
And you know what? and also feels really nice when we forgive someone rather than just staying all upset at them. Do you want to hear a good Bible verse about forgiveness? It's from Matthew 6. If you forgive not knowing their trespasses, the mistakes that others made, neither will your Heavenly Father forgive your trespasses, the mistakes that you made.
Oh, I see. If I don't forgive Pete for taking the picture, then Jesus can't forgive me when I do something else that's wrong. Oh, I don't want that.
You know you don't, Sammy. You're a good soldier. You know, taking the first step to apologize to someone you feel upset at is really pretty hard to do. But you always feel so much better after you with it.
I guess I should go tell Pete I'm sorry for not forgiving. I'll go do that right now, Pete.
Good for you. Yes, come in.
Back to you, don't you?
Oh, Sammy, what's up?
You were right. I told Pete that I forgave Kate my kitchen. And I was sorry for getting mad. He really didn't take it on purpose, you know.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And then we looked at the art supply store to find another kitchen for my mommy. Look, isn't this beautiful? I'm going to color and give it to my mommy. Pete will even give me a special sticker that he has to put on.
Thank you, Jesus. What a wonderful, happy ending. It pays to forgive.
Well, bye-bye, Auntie Ruth. Thanks a lot.
Chicken.
A male chicken is called a rooster. Ever since creation, roosters, or cocks as they are sometimes called, have crowed at dawn when the sun rises. So other roosters know that that is his territory and that he rules the roost. The roost is the place where the hens lay their eggs. His cock-a-doodle-doo is like an alarm clock that wakes you up. A female chicken is called a hen, and she lays eggs, like the ones that you eat at breakfast time. Mommy hens sit on some of their eggs, the ones that have baby chicks in them, to keep them warm. But even though the shell is so strong outside, just a little tiny peck, and the chicken being inside the egg, will crack the shell so that the little chick can come out. The little chicks are very soft and fuzzy and yellow. They're very cute, and they look like little yellow pups. From the very first day they're born, they are strong enough to follow the mother around and find food for themselves. Chickens are usually fed grain and other seeds. They peck up the seeds with their beaks, and they also scratch and peck at the ground to find other bugs and insects, which they also like to eat. Mother hens love their chicks very much and take very good care of them. Do you remember the story of the little hen and Mrs. Grandpa 1? There was a fire on the farm, and when the fire came close, the mother hen gathered all her chicks under her wings to protect them. And that's just the way Jesus is with us. He loves to bring us close to him and hold us in his arms. When we pray, we're getting close to Jesus, and he can hold us in his arms. Well, isn't that sweet? Thank you, Jesus. I love you, children. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Crippled Mary's Prayer List.
Here's a beautiful story that happened many years ago. It's about a sweet, crippled girl named Mary.
Oh, hi, Richard. How are you? Did you come to see Mary?
Yes.
Oh, she's a real fighter and a real cheerful blessing to me. But her health hasn't been so good recently. She hasn't been feeling so well. I think that you may go to see Jesus soon. But your visits are always such an encouragement to her. She'll be so glad to see you. Please come on in.
Thank you.
Come in. Mary, there's someone very special here to see you. Hi, Uncle Richard.
Hello, Mary.
Uncle Richard, I'm so happy to see you.
How have you been feeling, baby?
Well, you see, I love Jesus so much, and I want to do something for him. But I'm crippled, and I walk, and I'm so sick that I can't really witness for Jesus. What can I do?
Well, then, I'll pray against Jesus, and he'll show you.
Yes, Uncle Richard, that's what I'll do. Thank you so much. I want to witness for you, Jesus. Please show me how I can. Please, Jesus, show me. Thank you, Jesus. What a good idea. Thank you, Jesus. That's wonderful.
Hello, sweetheart. Can I get you anything?
Yes, Mommy. Could I please have some gold for nursing papers and a pencil and a paper? Jesus, show me a way that I can witness for him.
Amazing. Something wonderful is happening in my life. Yes, miracles are happening in all sorts of people's lives. I mean, who would have ever thought of Mr. Smith asking Jesus into his heart of all people? Yes, and that sweet woman who just left to be a missionary in India. Mr. and Mrs. Jones got saved and their children. And they're opening a Sunday school to teach more children. It's amazing.
And more people getting saved every day.
Really, Uncle Richard?
Yes.
More souls? Can you please tell me their name?
Well, there's Mr. and Mrs. Jones, Mr. Lambert, Alice and Tony, Jake Smith from the Creek, and even little freckled Sammy Piper.
That's a real miracle, Richard.
Yes, it is.
Not long afterwards, Mary left her sick, tired body and went home to be with Jesus.
I think she was taken this last week.
She was so happy.
Yes, it's so amazing. The past couple of weeks, she's been so happy. What's this? I just found this notebook under the mattress. There are lists and lists of names with checks by the names. As though she were checking them off for some reason. I wonder what it could mean.
Of course. This is your daughter's prayer list.
she's been praying for all these people, and she has been checking off their names that she heard they got saved.
Oh, wow. So that's why so many people are getting saved and coming to know Jesus.
No wonder she was so happy and excited. Usama told her the names of those who received the Lord. Because Jesus was answering her prayers for them. He's the Lord. Bless her.
He's the Lord.
What great faith little Mary had in prayer. Even though she was sick and crippled and not able to go out witnessing, look at all the souls she won to the Lord just by her prayer.
The Book of Acts, Chapter 9. In this chapter, we will see a miracle take place in the life of a man named Saul. Do you remember Saul? He was the man guarding the clothes of the man who was stoning Stephen. And later on, he persecuted the Christians himself as he went into every house where the disciples of Jesus were and took them to prison, both men and women. Well, at the beginning of this chapter, Saul went right to the high priest and got some special letters that gave him permission to persecute even more Christians way off in Damascus. So he set off with some of his men, full of hate, wanting to arrest the Christians there and bring them back, bound with chains. It was a long way up from Jerusalem to Damascus, as you can see on the map. But something very important happened on the road to Damascus. As they journeyed towards the city, suddenly a bright light shone all around Saul, a light from heaven. Brighter than the sun, and he fell to the ground. Then Saul heard a voice from heaven saying,
"Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?"
Saul answered,
"Who art thou, Lord?"
And the Lord answered,
"I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest."
Saul was shocked. He was full of fear and shaking when he asked,
"What wilt thou have me to do?"
Jesus said,
"Arise and go into the city of Damascus, and it shall be told you what thou must do."
The men which journeyed with him were afraid when they heard the voice, but they didn't see anybody. When Saul stood up, the brightness of the light had blinded his eyes. So the men that were with him had to lead him by the hand to the city, where he stayed 3 days without being able to see, nor eat or drink. Now in the city of Damascus lived a disciple named Ananias. Not Ananias who lied to Peter about his money in chapter 5. This Ananias was a very sweet man, and the Lord appeared to him in a vision saying,
"Arise and go into the street which is by the square, and look for a man named Saul of Tarsus, that he might receive his sight, for he is praying."
But Ananias replied,
"Lord, I have heard how much evil this man has done to your disciples, and how he came here from Jerusalem with orders from the high priest to put all the Christians in prison."
But the Lord answered,
"Go, for I have chosen him to be a witness for me to all the people."
So Ananias went and entered the house and prayed for Saul that he might receive his sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately scales fell from his eyes, and he could see again. Thank you, Jesus. Soon, Paul preached in the synagogue that Jesus was the Son of God. And all that heard him were amazed and said, "Isn't he the man that came to persecute the Christians and arrest them?" But this didn't bother Saul at all. He just got more on fire and kept on witnessing for many days, showing them clearly that Jesus was Christ. This made his enemies so angry that they decided to stop him. Day and night they watched the gates of the city to kill him. But during the night, the disciples helped Saul to escape by letting him down the wall of the city in a basket. He got away! What a miracle! When he came to Jerusalem, he wanted to join the disciples there, but they were all afraid of him and did not believe that he had become a disciple. Then Barnabas
God bless him, took him to Peter and James and explained how Saul had seen Jesus by the road and that he had spoken to him and how Saul had been preaching boldly in Damascus. Then they believed, and Saul stayed with them, witnessing boldly about Jesus. But again his enemies wanted to take his life, so the disciples helped him escape to Caesarea, where he took a ship to Tarsus. From there he sailed away, living the rest of his life telling people about Jesus everywhere. God bless him, a completely changed man. Thank you, Jesus.
Hiram Judson. In the year 1811, an American man named Adoniram Judson boarded an English ship to sail to India. He believed that God had called him to be a missionary. But at this time, England and France were fighting a war, and the English ship on which Adoniram Judson traveled was captured by the French army, and Adoniram was led away with the other sailors.
Come with us.
I think you've been a bit mistaken.
Right? Yes,
please listen to me. You have not paid the order. I'm American. I'm a missionary. Please don't put me in prison. I've done nothing wrong.
You will be in prison until this war is over.
And now move. Go. Please help me. Oh, Jesus, I know that you must have some purpose for letting this happen to me. I know that you call me to go be a missionary to the people that you respect. How can I do this if I'm shut in this prison? I'm doing your work, Jesus. Now, you have to believe in me. King David prayed in Psalms 142, deliver me from my persecutors, for they are stronger than I. Bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. Amen. How did you get in? Who are you, Saul?
Fear for the Son. Now, don't stop to ask any questions.
Right.
There's an American ship in the harbor. Get aboard her and be safe.
Adoniram Judson never found out who his rescuer had been. But undoubtedly, he was sent by the Lord in his hour of need. God is always faithful to deliver his children. Adoniram Judson went on to be a very faithful missionary in Burma, where he won many souls to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. He had an important job to do, witnessing for Jesus. And the Lord wasn't about to let the enemy stop him, no matter what. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah.
Faith, the title deed.
Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. In the original Greek language, the word substance was hypostasis. That's a big word. Long ago, about 400 years ago, in the time of King James of England, some people were translating the New Testament into English from the Greek language, but they didn't know what the word hypostasis meant. So they chose the word substance. Substance means something very specific, something real. But they weren't able to find the exact meaning of the word hypostasis. until much later. Then, well, guess what happened? Some archaeologists made a very interesting discovery. Archaeologists are people who study the past. They look for objects or remains of buildings in order to find out about life in the past. So one day, a group of archaeologists went to Palestine near the city of Caesarea in the north of Israel. They made a very important discovery. They found the ruins of an old inn. Part of the walls were still standing, and they found different things inside, like some pieces of pottery. There in the ruins of the inn, the archaeologists found a small chest.
Oh, wait, wait. Amazing. It's a chest. Amazing.
The inn was destroyed by fire, but the small chest was preserved. And when they opened it, they found some jewels inside and different papers, which were still preserved and could still be read. And guess what was written on top of each document? The word hypostasis. The same word in the verse about faith. The word that was used in the original Greek New Testament. These papers were title deeds to the properties owned by a rich Roman lady. Do you know what a title deed is? It is a paper that proved that she owned certain pieces of land. She was a Roman lady who lived in Rome, in Italy. After the Roman soldiers conquered Palestine, they sold land to the people. And this lady bought a few pieces of land and received those documents to prove that these different lands belonged to her. She had probably never even seen them, but she knew that they belonged to her because she had those title deeds, proof that they belonged to her. If you've got the faith, it's like you have the title deed in your hands. It's yours. Your name is written on it, and you will see it eventually. Real faith knows, and it happens. It never fails. So now we can read this verse again. Faith is the title deed, the proof that we have it, to the things we hope for, and the evidence of things not seen. And how do we have faith? Romans 10:17 says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The future is as bright as the promises of God. Do you have the title deed of faith in your hand?
Hello, my name is Claire. I'll be your hostess on today's edition of Family Adventures. Shall we pray for our show today? Thank you, Lord. Jesus, thank you for this special time to share family adventures together. Please bless it and inspire us as we see the fruits of your Spirit working miracles all around us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today we have some different witnessing adventures. Most of you children probably have school at home with family teachers, right? When we get our schooling at home, it's called homeschooling. In our homes, we can learn all about God's Word and Jesus at the same time as our scholastics. But sometimes we can't have school in our family homes. This has happened to some children, where the Lord had a special mission for them to go to public schools. If this ever happens to you, or if you're doing that right now, it's a really good time to witness and let your light so shine. You can be a sample of how much you love Jesus and show what good witnessing training you've gotten. Would you like to hear some exciting testimonies from children who witnessed when going to public school? Here's one from 9-year-old Sonrisa in a South American country called Venezuela.
A miracle happened one day when my sister and I went to school. We were all sitting in the classroom, but on that day our regular teacher didn't come. A different teacher came and taught us a Bible class. She taught all the children in the class about salvation, but she didn't pray with them. So my sister and I stood up and asked the teacher, "Is it okay if we teach all the children a prayer to ask Jesus into their hearts?" The teacher said yes. So we prayed with all 28 children in the class, and the teacher got saved too. Praise the Lord!
That was a very inspiring testimony. Sometimes the Lord can open some very amazing doors to witness, if you are listening and following His leads.
Here's a testimony about just that. And to tell us about it, we have a faithful correspondent.
Hello, everyone. This testimony is from Beth in the United States, and she's 11 years old. One day at school, and during one of her classes, the teacher told all the children that they shouldn't talk to each other at all. After she finished the school work she had to do, Beth remembered that she hadn't won any souls that day. So as she was sitting at her desk, the Lord showed her an idea. Beth wrote the salvation prayer on a little piece of paper and passed it to the girl who was sitting next to her. This girl passed it on to another person and another, and altogether, five souls got saved through the silent witness. Praise God.
Like Grandpa said, faithfulness in the little things is a great thing. So remember to obey the still small voice when you hear Jesus telling you to do something or witness to somebody. Here's our last report today, which is another good one about how little things lead to big things.
Heaven was 13 years old. She hadn't witnessed to all her friends at school yet, and the Lord showed her that she should try to get them saved. So one day, while they were playing in the schoolyard during recess time, that's the break time between the classes, Heaven told her guiltily about Jesus and prayed with her to ask Jesus into her heart. Heaven's friend was so happy to have Jesus in her heart that she ran and called some of her friends, and other friends, and still more friends. She brought 14 of her other friends over to see Heaven. She told all of them about Jesus, and they all got saved. That was 50 souls saved right there on the spot.
You can be a witness too, no matter what you're doing. Just do your best, and Jesus will do the rest, okay? Keep witnessing and letting your little light so shine for Jesus. Praise the Lord. I love you.
Flying saucers, UFOs, and spiritual vehicles.
There are really important angels that can go anywhere under God's orders. Through space, the universe, etc. They require no vehicle except the flying saucer. The angels travel in a circular vehicle of light or energy. People long ago represented this circle of light around the head, which they called halos. But today, people call them flying saucers. There are UFOs. They are spirit beings, and they do appear, and people have seen them. Technicians have scientifically tracked them. They have appeared as signs in the sky to unbelieving man. That's the way certain angels travel. Their speed and the way they move is so fast that only a spirit could survive such forces. Do you want to know how the Lord travels? It's already in the Bible, the whole thing, in Ezekiel chapter 1. You can read it with your teacher. I think that Ezekiel's vision was of Jesus. God, the Father, is everywhere and beyond our understanding. So thank God for His heavenly beings, His ministering spirits, and angels who are watching over us continually and helping us all the time. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily befall us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. God bless you. I love you.
Thank you.
were pushed away. For people said, Jesus to my hand. He said to me,
I'm your forever friend. I'll always take the time for you. I'm your forever friend. I have a special love for you.
It's time for...